compulsive checking. It's a defensive checking. You see the kids, once they have those social media apps, they're keeping an eye on it all the time, and that is a chronic stressor for them. So if they're having Twitter, or some of those that or even Tumblr, there's several, I'll give you those, you're going to start seeing that compulsive checking, and it's sad. It's hard on them, but they're not going to give it up if you allow. And keep in mind that adolescents, you know, are supposed to be kind of jerks. Like, it's developmentally appropriate, and it's normal. They're supposed to be curious. They're supposed to be exploring. They're supposed to be rolling their eyes at you and thinking you're super stupid. You know, their prefrontal regions are blossoming, and they're, like, figuring stuff out, and they can finally think about thinking for the first time. That's why young people start social movements, because they get idealistic all of a sudden. You know, they're able to see things we don't see. And they don't have those layers of experience that modulate their optimism. So there's a lot about teenagers that's very healthy, even though it's kind of a pain for us as their parents. So that means they deserve a lot of compassion and some room, and failure is okay. Even failure online, you have to allow some of that. That's how they learn. You can't protect them without interfering with that learning process. Okay, so in regard to social media, viewing is a risk, posting is a risk, and instant messaging is a risk. Okay, so you're not only worrying about what they post that's going to humiliate your family and themselves, but you're also worried about what they're reading and accessing. That's what parents miss. A lot of times we're so focused on what behavior they're going to do, we don't really realize what they're going to access and what kind of trouble that has. So I'm going to show you a little bit about what kind of trouble that can. And if you're sensitive to images, this is where you need to cover your face, okay? Because there's a trigger warning here. All right, so literally, I promise you, it took me 5 minutes to find these images on Instagram. And Instagram is one of the least problematic of social media that I have. They're the ones I say, you know, go ahead and start out with Instagram, because it's image-based, and it's not as difficult. But, you know, check this out. It's not just posting on Instagram that they can get into trouble with, but they can view things quite quickly. Because when you're teaching your kids skills, you need to let them know that the internet hates, and the internet particularly hates women. So you can get pornography and political things and violence, and they're gonna have access to that. Not only does the internet hate, but the internet also recruits, and I talked to you a little bit about it, recruiting for cults and organizations that you would disapprove of and that could be dangerous to them. The internet's the best thing that ever happened to cults, because it used to be that the only way cults could get to your kids is if they're on a city street and they come up and talk to them, but now you can groom kids in their home day after day, month after month, year after year, and their parents don't know. And they can say things like, your parents don't understand you, but I do. Right? And they can play on that idealism that, you know, these guys are marketers. They know exactly how to groom and interfere with relationships. The internet also accepts any behavior. You see cutting, which is a contagious behavior. I see this in my office a lot. Once one kid starts cutting in an inpatient facility, you gotta watch it, because they all start cutting. And that can be a scary behavior that gets out of control very quickly. Also, domestic violence and relationships peak during the teenage years, and also eating disorders. So this says, I'm not going to post any pictures of me because I'll get reported, because people can't stand to see me. I'm so fat and ugly. Maybe when I get to like 100 followers, if I even get there, I'll post a picture of my cuts or something. I don't know. You don't need to know me, my name. For now, you can just call me the unwanted girl. So there's also pro-anorexia websites. There's pro-suicide websites. There's pro-cutting websites that teaches kids exactly how to do this stuff. And the darknet, Jamie Bartlett, actually spent a lot of time about these pro-am websites. And, you know, it's not what you think. It's not like you go on them and they say, okay, do this and do this and do this. It's a community that's supportive and loving and kind, but they're doing the kind of therapy that's the wrong kind of therapy. There are other people who are cutting and losing weight. They teach them how to lose more weight, how to live on fewer calories. And that kind of community is hard to turn away from, because nobody else understands like those communities. The internet's also a place for predators, trolls, and cyberbullying. You see catfishing. I think I'm allowed to talk about it. Maybe I'm not. So I won't say that the Learning Channel is filming a pilot coming up here about parents and their teens. I won't say the title because I don't know if I'm allowed to yet. But I'm going to be their recurring expert on camera. And they're talking about catfishing. Catfishing is when you pretend to be somebody else. Even when you're not, have you guys seen the catfishing show on MTV? That's kind of an interesting watch. I recommend you do it. That Cassidy Wolf, that teen, Miss Teen USA was on that news spot. She was a guest on it the other day, and I watched it with my teenagers. 82% of sex offenders use a victim's social networking site to gain information. It's not hard. You know, you can tell pretty quickly what town they live in, you know, what community they live in, what their activities are. They also use it for spreading rumors, threatening, and intimidating. This is not actually new to most of you, probably. Setting up embarrassing situations and filming it for slam books. Creating jokes or hashtags. You know, hashtags are if you hashtag a picture, then it shows up on a special page with everything that's been hashtagged like that. So they'll do hashtags for viral spreading, like, you know, Dr. Bennett sucks. You know, then anybody who puts something up and says hashtag Dr. Bennett sucks, it all goes on this one page. And it's a very effective way to spread viral messages. They also cyberbully through active exclusion. That's really easy to do. You know, all you do is have a party and you don't invite that one girl, and then you take a picture and make sure she notices that she's not in there. And if you're worried she doesn't see it, just tag her on that. You know, pretend she's there when she's not, and then she'll for sure see that she's been excluded. Also, AskFM is another social media site that I don't like. In fact, I wrote an article on AskFM, and then they called me and said, you know, we're concerned that you don't know about the new safety features that we've implemented on AskFM. Can we talk to you? We set up an appointment. I actually met them in D.C. And they do, you know, they're taking it more seriously. This is one of those social media apps that's based in America. Many of them are based overseas, and there's not a thing you can do about it. But they made some efforts to make it a more friendly site, but it's still a virtual bathroom stall. You can put anything on it, you can be anonymous. And what they do, the kids call it F, Kill, and Marry. Have you heard of this? So any picture that goes up, they rate it, whether she's F-able, killable, or marryable. So it's a way of ranking based on attractiveness. And I've had girls getting triggered for major depressive episodes because they've been, you know, without they didn't post the picture, they didn't ask for that kind of rating, but, you know, they were the target of cyberbullying. I've had a lot of boys come in and ask me to call the principal. You know, there'll be a Twitter string, and, you know, I had one of my guys come in and he said, you know, this really happened, this really nice kid. Everybody started picking on him, and he started out responding to them, and by the end of the string, he quit responding and said, maybe I don't deserve to live. And so my kid came in, you know, he was up all night worried this kid had killed himself. He said, call the principal, will you please, and make sure this kid's okay. You know, this stuff is happening every day all the time. The kid was okay, and the school was responsive. Thanks for letting me know. It's called a welfare check. So if you're ever worried about somebody you see, you know, being bullied online, call the school, the administration, and law enforcement. They're very equipped now to manage this stuff, and usually they're really on. And it's also easy to do, you know, flaming, subtweeting, humor. Teenagers are just brutal, just the way they talk to each other. So a lot of it's done in humor, and it's horrifying to us, but to them it's just the culture, it's just the way it is. And the internet is very much like that. It's very sexist, it's scary, it's against any minority or anybody with power. This is an author, Anita Sarkeesian, who is speaking out against sexualized female characters or pornographic images in video games. Because video games would reward their players by sending them, you know, a soft porn cartoon picture of a woman. And overwhelmingly, gamers are male, and the average age is 30. It's not for kids, really, even though there's kids on there, but the average gamer is 30. And she was saying, you know, look, we've got to start treating women better. And as a result of just speaking out and saying, look, we need to treat women better, you know, she was violated by that kind of language on a regular basis, overwhelmingly. And had to take a lot of her social media down just because of the stalking and the verbal abuse. And those are the things your kids are going to see. So one of the most valuable things I offer for Get Kids Internet Safe is this living agreement because it's so comprehensive. So that parents could take with their kids, and it's too much to do in one night, but it gives you a checklist of things that you can go over to make sure you cover everything, and then you can supplement that with the articles that you can search, you know, so that you're sure that they have all their skills and they're aware of everything that they're going to run into. And it also allows you to really teach your family's values and your goals and how you're going to treat them. Now, one thing I tell parents all the time is parents are loath to set limits with screen media because they don't want to live by those limits, you know, because we don't want to put our phones away. I mean, if my kid said, we have blackout Tuesday and Thursday, you have blackout Tuesday and Thursday, I would say, oh, my dead body, am I going without my screens all day Tuesday and Thursday? But guess what? I don't have to live by the rules they live by because my prefrontal region is already developed and I'm a parent. So it's okay to have a parent set of rules and a kid set of rules. We've earned it. We bought them. It's our house, and we know what we're doing, and we have this much more control than they have, at least. So if you're a parent who's avoiding setting limits because you don't want to set limits yourself, just set limits with them then and pair yours back. Because kids overwhelmingly are saying, I'm having a hard time getting my mom and dad's attention because they're overtasked as well. We're overtasked. We're getting inundated by our notifications. You know, the truth is that my university students are way better about putting their screens away than adults are. They're just trained to do it. I never hear their phones go off during class. I swear I really don't. Part of it's because I threaten them with their lives and they're scared of me because I'm not mean. But they really don't. But adults forget it because, you know, we're not used to that. That we're tech immigrants, not tech natives like they are. All right, so on those living agreements, we do things like no tech Tuesday, no tech Thursday. My kids are allowed to pick any 2 days they want to be off their screens. They almost always pick their day they have soccer or volleyball anyway, so it's not that big of a deal. More power to them. You know, if anything, it makes them sign up for activities because they're like, if I'm gonna be home doing nothing but climbing trees, then I might as well go to soccer. And that's what we do. I'm like, cool, go to soccer. Then that'll be your no tech day, right? And when they're teenagers and they need to do homework, that's a different deal. Then I have to allow them enough to do their homework. But I just set parental controls. There's a thing called OurPact. OurPact is a free service. You download it, and it can block all their internet. And then if they call you and say, but mom, I have to browse for my book report, then I can allow them access to that one technology thing. So our tech tools out there are amazing if you know how to access them. But you have to keep up on them. All right, this one I actually like. It's kind of torture, but it's my custom kind of torture, which I love. I raise resilient kids mostly by, you know, teasing them and hassling them. And so my 14-year-old wants Snapchat. She's after it. I'm the only one at school who doesn't have Snapchat.